No, please write. Welcome to Term 3. In Term 3, we'll take Chapter 22, 23, and 24. We're starting now with Chapter 22, which is Risk Management. There are two sections of this chapter, which is identifying business risk, and the second section is dealing with risks. Section Objectives. Explain why is risk invaluable. Describe speculative risk. Describe the three categories of pure risk. These are the three three objectives of this section. So let's start. The main idea of this section is risk is a fact for every entrepreneur. Every person, every entrepreneur has to face some risks. However, to build a successful business and maximize profits, they must understand the risk and understand how to deal with it in order to make good decisions. What are the contents of this section? Speculative risk, pure risk, burglary, robbery, electronic credit card authorizers, and negatives. Now let's start. Risk is invaluable. What does that mean? Every business must or has to face risk. It's the possibility of losing or winning a situation. This is risk. Risk is when I face into a situation that I might lose or gain in this situation. Business risk falls into two general categories, speculative risk and pure risk. Now let's understand what is speculative risk. Speculative risk is the risk that is inherent to a business involving a chance of either profit or loss. So, speculative risk is when I take a decision in the business and I don't know where will this decision take me. Will it take me to a place where I will gain profit or in a place where I will lose my money? For example, a new marketing product. Marketing, a new way to market a product or a new product in the business. Let's give an example, a real life case example. When Apple introduced iPhone 11, they were not sure they will gain or they will lose. Because iPhone 11 is similar to iPhone X or iPhone 10, but the difference is it only has 3 or 4 products. So this is speculative risk. It's when I introduce a product into the market, I don't know that I will gain or lose. Another example that happened recently, some clothing businesses has changed their business line, which is the clothing line, into making face masks to prevent coronavirus. Now they don't know, they win or they lose. They don't know if this coronavirus will stay, it will increase or it will get less, let's say. So this is speculative risk. I take a decision or I go into a decision. I don't know where I will lose or I gain or make profits. Is this clear? Now, however, pure risk is the risk that is a threat of a loss to the business. So this is the risk that I have faced or I face, and I know I'll lose out of it. I'll not gain anything out of it. Such as natural disasters, a flood, an accident, or an employee theft, or a robbery. So pure risk is when I know that this risk that I will face will not make me gain any profits. I'll lose. Such as the coronavirus happening right now. Many businesses are losing out of business, or they are going out of business, or they are losing some of their money because their risk, the coronavirus is a risk for them that they will not gain anything out of it. Is this clear? Okay. Now let's go to pure risk. What are the three categories of pure risk? Crime, natural disasters, and accidents. These are three categories of pure risk that every business might face. However, small businesses are 35 more times likely than larger businesses to be victims of crime. What are the crimes that small businesses might face? Shoplifting, employee theft, burglary, robbery, stolen credit cards, bad checks, counterfeit money, and cybercrimes. These are the main crimes that every small business or most small businesses might face. Now let's start with shoplifting. What is shoplifting? It's when I come to a shop, let's say, I take something without the owner knowing or the cashier knowing, and I don't pay for it and I go out. This is shoplifting. Now what are the techniques to reduce shoplifting? One, to train employees to recognize shoplifters. Shoplifters could have certain characteristics that are common by all, and when I train my employees to recognize these characteristics, I would reduce the fact of having shoplifting. I'll give you an example. Many shoplifters will not act normally. They act like they are stressed or they are trying to see if people are seeing them or not. This is one characteristic that is common between all shoplifters. So if I am an employee and I know how to recognize this characteristic, I would help my business to not face shoplifting. The second technique is to keep the store well lit, put visible lights, and make every corner of the shop visible, make the merchandise visible. The third technique is to employ two-way mirrors, to put mirrors in the business to see the corners or the areas that you cannot see, put peepholes or CCTV cameras. So what is the third technique? It's to employ two-way mirrors, peepholes or CCTV cameras. The fourth technique is to use tamper-proof price tickets or electronic tags. I think all of you have seen this. Whenever you buy a shirt or a bag, there would be a tamper-proof price ticket, a price ticket that they have to take out before you leave the shop. This is one way to stop shoplifting. So when I take the shirt and the cashier takes out this price ticket, I can easily go out without these devices on the door being beeping on me. Or electronic tags, the tags that look like circuits. So these two ways, these two tickets, electronic tags or tickets, can help to stop shoplifting by putting them on the product, and whenever a person goes out without paying for this, the devices on the door will start beeping or lighting up. Okay? And the fifth and last technique is to hire a security guard. Put a security guard in your shop. They could see if people are taking things out of the shop or not. So these are the five techniques where I train my employees on, I use them in my company or my shops in order to stop shopping. I hope this is clear. Now, employee theft. What is employee theft? It's when an employee comes to the business, takes anything that is valuable out of the business to his own use, such as money, pencils, papers, records, things that are valuable for the business. Now, what are the ways to discourage employee theft? First one is to establish policies and communicate them verbally and in writing. Put out policies, put out rules of what employees should and should not do. Communicate them to the employees by a meeting, let's say, verbally, and in writing by making a manual for them. Number two, lock up all doors that are not needed to be used for entry or exit. If you know that people or employees will use one door, close other doors that get into the company or make people go out of the company. You don't need to use all entries and exits. Use the ones that are needed only. Number three, watch your trash for stolen items. Most of the things that people steal will hide them in the trash. So watch your trash for stolen items. Number four, control the distribution of keys or other security devices. If you have a store in the company that keeps the valuable things in, don't give the key to anyone. Give it to the people who are responsible of this place. Also the security devices. Keep them with people who are responsible and solely responsible for them. These are the four ways in order to stop employee theft. Now let's go to burglary. What's the difference between burglary and robbery? Burglary is the act of breaking into and entering the building without the intent to commit a felony. What's a felony? A serious crime. So you enter the business or the company, and you're not trying to create a crime, but you're trying to steal something out. This is burglary. What is robbery? Robbery is the taking the property by force. So you go into the business, you force people to give you what you want with the threat. Let's say a weapon or a gun. So burglary is I go into the business, I steal without people knowing. I commit the crime without people knowing. Robbery is I go into with a weapon, a gun, a stick, and I try to take the property by force. I think this is clear. Now what are stolen cards? Stolen credit cards. It's the cards that people take from others and they start using them. How can we stop it? We have a device that is called electronic card authorizer, where it's a machine that verifies whether the credit card is stolen or it's good to you. So let's say God forbid, I steal a credit card from someone. I go to a shop to use it. They could have this electronic card authorizer. They put the card first there before transacting the purchase, and they see if this card is stolen or good to use. After they make sure that this card is good to use, they can transact the product that I bought and they give it to me. However, if it's stolen, they will tell the police and they'll file a case for it. This is the stolen credit card. Natural disasters. Natural disasters are such as tornadoes, earthquakes, and floods. Now, these are pure risks that we cannot avoid. These are things that come by nature. We can stop them into a limit, but we cannot avoid them at all. How can you protect your business against the natural disasters? You can install certain detectors or certain things that can help you avoid these natural disasters, such as installing smoke detectors and sprinkler systems in the business where you can avoid fire, and you can protect your cash or documents in a fireproof safe room where the walls are being fireproofed. I think this is clear. Accidents and injuries is another way of pure risk that businesses might face, and they are handled for it negligence. It's the failure to exercise responsible care. So if I'm negligent with accidents, they might make me lose certain money, such as, let's say, I do not give my employees training on how to use a machine. Okay? And this machine is, let's say, a risk, or it's dangerous for people to use. Now, I can get an employee who can, let's say, cut his hand using this machine. Now, when he cuts his hand, I have to pay for him insurance. And this is the pure risk. This is negligence. I did not give them training, so they went into the accident or the injury, where they made me pay for them the medical insurance. Is it clear? Please let me know if it's not. And this is the end of section 22.1. So after we have understood, please answer these questions. Explain why risk is inevitable. Number 2, describe speculative risk. And number 3, describe the 3 categories of pure risk. I hope to see you next time. In good health.